Good morning and welcome to our online service this morning on this first Sunday of Lent. Our candles have been lit again this morning, one to represent the Christian Church in our world and to remember those whose profession of faith subjects them to isolation, persecution and abuse. We remember those who are unable to worship God with the freedom that we often take for granted. The second candle, as always, is for our COVID pandemic, giving thanks for the vaccine and continuous research, for all who are working overtime and volunteers to ensure that so many people receive the vaccination. And we pray that the United Kingdom will be committed and proactive in ensuring that the vaccination is made available to others in underdeveloped countries and work alongside the World Health Organizations and others involved in this humane programme. We continue to uphold all those who are suffering with COVID, all who care for them, and those who have suffered loss. Let us worship God. We gather as God's people, seeking to live God's way in our lives. We come together in love, rejoicing that Jesus shared our human experience and lived among us. We come together in faith and hope. I would like to read a short invocation for Lent taken from Iona Community Book, Lent and Easter Readings. Into the dark world a snowdrop comes, a blessing of hope and peace, carrying within its green heart a symbol of God's renewing love. Come to inhabit our darkness, Lord Christ, for dark and light are alike to you. May nature's white candles of hope remind us of your birth and lighten our journey through Lent and beyond. Let us pray. Gracious and merciful God, on this first Sunday of Lent, we come together to worship you, to praise and thank you, to seek forgiveness and to ask for renewal. Create in each one of us a clean heart, O Lord, and renew a right spirit within us. We come in the name of Christ, remembering his lonely days in the wilderness, his time with wrestling temptation, and the ministry that followed, restoring and transforming so many lives. Help us to learn from his example, to search our hearts as he did, to consider our calling, to reflect on our faith, to resist temptation, and to commit ourselves more wholly to you. Living God, we pray for those people who have lost hope, for those who have given up on life. We pray for those weighed down by the stresses and strains of daily life, for those oppressed by worry, weighed down by guilt, or unable to throw off their anxieties. Reach out to each one of them and grant them that peace you alone can give. And in the silence of our own hearts, we bring before you our own private prayers. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. We have now entered the season of Lent, an important season in the Christian year. Next week I'm doing a service with our guiding family for Thinking Day, as I feel that it's important to include our young people in the life of our church. And if we remain in lockdown, I will invite others to share the services in the future, or hopefully even better, within our church. This morning I want us to reflect on Jesus, his period in the wilderness, and the way to the cross. The Lenten journeys is one that takes us through different types of landscape, different backdrops and scenes, in which are set critical, decisive moments in the life of Jesus, the Son of God, and by extension, the world of faith. Barren wilderness gives way to the dirt roads, the towns and villages along the way, mountains and valleys, and ultimately a city, a hill and a garden. Lent has become, in the life of the church, an intentionally rough terrain, a place of self-sacrifice or denial. For many, this past year has been in some ways a wilderness experience. However, the nature of this experience has depended on the nature of our work or lack of it, our living in either remote or crowded territory, or for some, lockdown in a high-rise flat, or surrounded by a welcome garden. The ability to have or to hoard more essentials of life, and of course our health, and sadly for some, experience of loss of different kinds. Are we really in all this together? What is the landscape of life, of soul, in which we find ourselves today? How does the landscape of the Lenten journey speak to our own lives? I'll leave you to consider that one. In Mark's Gospel, we read of Jesus' journey from Nazareth to Galilee, the banks of the Jordan to the desert, and back to Galilee in a few short verses. Mark sets out who Jesus is and the task he has come to fulfill. Jesus grows up in an uncherished town. He is baptized in the river, along many others seeking renewal, who were willing to come from Jerusalem and the whole of the Judean countryside. As we've heard on many occasions, his temptation takes place in a barren landscape, and his preaching is back in the familiar territory of Galilee. Let's consider his temptation for a few moments. He had a period of isolation in the wilderness to prepare for the purpose for which he had come, death on a cross. During his time there, he was tempted again and again. He remained focused, acknowledging that his purpose was way more important than his personal needs. He didn't use or misuse his power at this time. He endured the wilderness experience. He looked beyond his own needs. He didn't consider himself more important. He knew the path ahead and trusted in God. He didn't compromise. He resisted temptation and left the wilderness to fulfill his ministry and purpose. He went to Galilee and proclaimed good news. Our lectionary reading from Mark 8, verses 31 to 38, informs us of Jesus' foretelling of his death and resurrection. Peter's rebuke reminds Jesus of different choices he could have made, like the ones he wrestled with in the desert. Hence the sharpness of his reply. The pressure on Jesus to be the kind of hero the crowd wanted, a miracle worker, a king who would stand up to the Romans, a national hero, was at times, as you can well imagine, relentless. The disciples must have been shocked when Jesus talked about the suffering that lay ahead. And Jesus clarifies that suffering lies ahead not only for himself, but for any who would follow him. Jesus at this point doesn't pull the wool over their eyes. He is clear that a cross will be involved for anyone who wants to be his followers. But those who walk his way will have him by their side. And instead of forfeiting their life, dissipating their soul's energy on countless pursuits that cannot satisfy, they will find themselves. Jesus outlines three elements for would-be followers. Self-denial, taking up a cross, and following him. As you're all aware, we are in Lent, that period of 40 days before Easter, when people and church traditions deny themselves excess. But self-denial might include giving up things and changing habits. But the key element should be a change of focus from oneself to God. Taking up a cross was the opposite to some of the privileged positions some of the disciples coveted at this time. And Jesus warned them all that life could and would become tougher because of their association with him. Crucifixion was a painful end for those who committed capital offences. To suggest that God was in any way close to shame was a scandal to the Greek-speaking world and a stumbling block to the Jewish world, who believed that a person who hung on a tree was cursed. Comparing Jesus' invitation between the three Gospels of Matthew, Mark and Luke, one of them makes a slight adjustment to the teaching. And Luke's amendment is, "Let them take up their cross daily and follow me," calling us therefore to live every day in the awareness of God and in sacrificial service to others. It is the road less travelled where we come to an end of a life with self at the centre and come alive to a life centred on Christ. Following Jesus turns out to be more than following a good example. It's taking up the invitation to live as Jesus did, wanting to be like him. During this Lenten season, let's reflect on the words of Jesus. "Whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me." What does that mean for us? What has it meant for others in the past? There are many who have been tortured and imprisoned because of their faith. And we have the privilege of worshipping God in freedom. We have the freedom of reading scripture if we so wish. And when lockdown is over, we can look forward to sharing Christian fellowship, sharing our faith and questions with others, listening, caring and supporting each other, reflecting on the way forward for the church and its mission. But do we spare a thought for those who do not have this freedom? We often hear stories of great sacrifice, people who have denied themselves and served others in Christ's name in challenging situations and continue to do so. We might get a bit of verbal abuse from others. They may mock our beliefs, consider us weak because we profess the Christian faith. They may accuse us of using God as a crutch to help us through life. Perhaps present us with challenging questions for which sometimes we do not have an answer. Jesus didn't promise an easy or a simple path, but he did promise that he would remain with us always. During Lent, let's reflect on our own journey of faith and on our calling to be like Christ and co-workers for the kingdom. Let's take time out to read the story of his passion and suffering, death, resurrection, and his promise, "Lo, I am with you always." I would like to close by reflecting on a well-known and much-loved hymn, based really on this theme. "Will you come and follow me if I but call your name? Will you go where you don't know and never be the same? Will you let my love be shown? Will you let my love be known? Will you let my life be grown in you and you in me? Will you leave yourself behind if I but call your name? Will you care for cruel and kind and never be the same? Will you risk the hostile stare? Should your life attract or scare? Will you let me answer prayer in you and you in me? Will you love the you you hide if I but call your name? Will you quell the fear inside and never be the same? Will you use the faith you've found to reshape the world around through my sight and touch and sound in you and you in me? May our response be, Lord, your summons echoes true when you but call my name. Let me turn and follow you and never be the same. In your company I'll go where your love and footsteps show. Thus I'll move and live and grow in you and you in me. Amen. Living God, equip us through your word, inspire us through your spirit, renew us by your grace, that we may share in the work of Christ and the growth of your kingdom. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us and all whom we love and pray for, in this world and the next. Amen.